Sticklebacks are small bony fish that exist in both freshwater and saltwater varieties. While this fish may look unassuming to most people, evolutionary biologists consider their story to be one of the greatest examples of evolution in action. Saltwater sticklebacks are heavily armored, with large spines on their back, along with a pelvic spine. This makes it difficult for largemouth predators to eat the saltwater form. Freshwater sticklebacks, however, tend to have less armor, and spines that are smaller, and sometimes non-existent. Before the 1980s, Loberg Lake was home to a native population of freshwater sticklebacks. Then, in 1982, the Alaska Department of Fish and Game poisoned the lake with the intention of killing the native sticklebacks in order to add recreational fish to the lake. 8 years later, researchers discovered that the lake had been recolonized by heavily armored saltwater sticklebacks. So far, so good. The native sticklebacks in Loberg Lake were gone, and a new colony of saltwater sticklebacks had taken their place. Then, something amazing happened. In 1991, researchers discovered that some of the fish in Loberg Lake resembled the native fish that lived in the lake a decade earlier. This reduced armor form began to spread through the lake's population, and by 2001, the fish with reduced armor made up 75% of the population of the lake. Genetic analysis revealed a mutation in a small region of DNA that regulated the production of certain proteins. A small region of this DNA had been spontaneously deleted. This deletion mutation resulted in fish with low armor and low spines. An analogy for this type of mutation might be a book with a missing page. The fish were adapting to their new environment, and researchers viewed this as an example of rapid evolution. Natural selection was favoring the fish with reduced armor and reduced spines. But why? After all, wouldn't it make sense for the fish to keep the armor to defend themselves from predators? There were actually several reasons why less armor was actually favorable. First, unlike the environment the fish had to face in the ocean, there weren't any largemouth predators in the lake that the fish had to worry about. This meant that the armor and spines were an unnecessary handicap. Second, while largemouth predators weren't an issue, dragonfly larvae were. Dragonfly larvae like to eat small sticklebacks by grabbing onto their pelvic spines and dragging them closer. This made pelvic spines a liability. The third reason is related to the first two. Heavy armor has obvious advantages, but it also slows the movement of small fish trying to swim away from predators. Less armor meant that it was easier to swim away from the dragonfly larvae. The fourth reason, again having to do with dragonfly larvae, is that sticklebacks with low armor tend to grow faster, meaning that if you are a baby stickleback, dragonfly larvae have less time to catch you and eat you before you reach adulthood. Just so that I am not creating confusion, as you can imagine, there are a number of stickleback species, and even individuals within a species can vary across a range of environments. However, for the sake of simplicity in this video, I chose to focus on just the basic freshwater form and the basic saltwater form in and around Loberg Lake. A lot of people have hailed this as a strong example of evidence for evolution. However, there are a number of factors to consider in evaluating this claim. What we've seen here is definitely a good example of mutation followed by natural selection. So what would critics of neo-Darwinian evolution, particularly biologists arguing for creation and biologists arguing for intelligent design, have to say? Creation biologists and intelligent design advocates agree with evolutionists that living things change. Mutation and natural selection are facts of biology. In fact, it was originally a creationist by the name of Edward Blyth who first proposed the idea of natural selection, not Charles Darwin. Biochemist and intelligent design advocate Michael Behe, for example, thinks that the universal tree of life is real, but doesn't think that natural processes alone are sufficient to explain every adaptation in the history of biology. Other biologists, especially those arguing for young Earth creation, think that the history of life is more akin to an orchard than to a single massive tree. In other words, biological changes occur. However, these changes don't explain the whole of what we see in life on Earth. With regards to sticklebacks, What we've seen here is a good example of natural selection in action, as well as a good example of a beneficial mutation. However, nothing fundamentally new was created. The genetic basis for this change was the deletion of regulatory information, not the creation of something fundamentally new. While I will probably receive flack from those who disagree with my view for saying this, when looked at carefully, none of the putative examples of evolution in action ever really show support for the idea of onward and upward evolution. There's a lot more that could be said here. However, covering every putative example of evolution in action is far beyond the scope of this video, but I will have links in the description box for more information. Focusing on just the example of sticklebacks, it is logically fallacious to equate the observed loss of genetic information in a fish with the idea that all of life on Earth arose from a universal common ancestor with no outside intelligence guiding the process. Textbooks will often define evolution as simply meaning change over time, or change in allele frequency, and leave students with the impression that critics of evolution deny that species change. These same textbooks will then switch the definition of evolution without informing the reader, lumping multiple concepts together as if they were one and the same. The problem is that this creates a logical fallacy, equating two different ideas as if they were one and the same, and also leaving students with the impression that you can't have one of these ideas without the other, namely, the fact that species change and the belief that natural causes can explain the origin of everything that we see in biology. So in summary, sticklebacks in Loberg Lake are a great example of a loss of genetic information, not the creation of fundamentally new information. Biological changes happen in populations. However, when looked at carefully, we do not see the types of changes required for the type of onward and upward evolution that Darwin imagined. Also, despite the misleading information that you may have heard in a classroom or in your textbooks, biologists on all sides of this debate agree that living things change, but they disagree on what these changes are capable of. As a biotech major, I once believed that evolution was good science. However, when I took the time to examine the evidence again in light of the arguments of biologists arguing for creation, I switched my way of thinking. Despite what you've probably been taught in class, there are thousands of biologists arguing for creation, and thousands more arguing for intelligent design. Unfortunately, many people, including most scientists, believe in evolution because they have only read the arguments of scientists on one side of the debate, and have only heard a misrepresentation of scientists on the other side of the debate. I challenge everyone watching this video to look into the arguments for various viewpoints for yourself, and to realize that there are well-recognized and well-respected experts, namely geneticists, biochemists, paleontologists, medical doctors, and a whole host of other well-respected scientists, on all sides of the creation, evolution, intelligent design debate.